Welcome to another edition of Inside Medicine. I'm your host, Doug Geinzer, and we're here in the studio today with Dr. Alfred Bonati, the founder and medical director of the world-renowned Bonati Spine Institute that recently expanded here to Las Vegas, Nevada. For those of you that are new to Inside Medicine, we broadcast live here in the studio every Friday morning at 10 o'clock. We bring in the innovators of healthcare, those that are doing amazing things, developing new devices, bringing medical travelers here into Las Vegas, those that are involved in medical education, and just doing great things for the healthcare community right here in Las Vegas. And today we've got Dr. Alfred Bonati, who actually fits almost all of those categories. Dr. Bonati, welcome back to the studio.
Thank you.
We've had you in the studio a few times or once before in the past, and we appreciate you coming back.
Thank you.
So last night, you had a grand opening. You opened up the Bonati Spine Institute of Las Vegas. What do you think?
I think it was very crowded.
Yeah, it was a very big event. Scott, if you could pull up that shot. We had about 200 folks in attendance throughout the night, and we had a lot of very, very influential people that came by to stop by, welcome you into the Las Vegas marketplace. Folks such as city council people, some legislators. We had even the sheriff pop by to say hello, the dean of the medical school, and we're going to get a little bit into the details about the event later on in the show, but for those of you that are new watching Inside Medicine, they may not have seen the last edition where we had you on. If you could take a few minutes, tell us a little bit about the Bonati Spine Institute and your background.
Well, the institute was developed with an idea to create a comprehensive type of medicine. So try to serve the patient that had one problem associated with the spine in toto. That means be able to have the diagnosis, the imaging, the x-rays, the physicians that they are going to participate and evaluate the patient, and then also to immediately be able to treat those patients. So the idea was to have a comprehensive system. Work very well in Florida. We were extremely successful for many years. Then recently we decided that will be a good idea to expand the results because we feel that the spine is a problem because there are too many answers of how to treat the spine. When you have too many answers of how to treat one problem in medicine, that means the problem is not really being corrected. That means they are testing if this will be better or that will be better. We developed something that is very exclusive. We have around 98.75% of patient satisfaction.
That's unheard of. That's amazing.
In a spine, is amazing. And in medicine, it's amazing. If you go to a doctor, even today, and you ask, is this procedure going to help me? And can you guarantee that the procedure will help me? The doctors will always say, no, we cannot guarantee a procedure because the body is totally different from one person to another one. Although anatomically is equal and similar, but the psychological reactions, the aging of the patient, the sex of the patient, all these things make the physician very uncomfortable to say this procedure will be successful in 90% of possibilities. We went beyond that. We developed a procedure that is successful almost 100%.
That's amazing.
Yes.
And so how many of these procedures have you done over the years?
Well, we have more than 55,000 procedures performed at the Institute. So the experience of the Institute and the surgeons' experience at this facility are enormous.
That's huge. We're so proud to have the Bonati Spine Institute expanding in right here into Las Vegas. So why Las Vegas?
Well, we had a institution in Florida that practically serve the northeast part of the country. Very seldom we see people coming from Washington State or Oregon, even California, because the distance.
Sure. I imagine with a back pain that nobody wants to get on a plane for 5 hours when they're in excruciating pain.
Yeah. And at the same time, they're not really very aware of their results because we don't have relationship with those states. Then it's difficult for the people that they are living in those states to really have information about us.
Sure.
So takes a long time to travel, takes very much expensive to travel. And some of the people are people that they are working, so they cannot take 2, 3, 4 weeks of free time to treat themselves. So we need to have an answer that will be bringing the procedure and the techniques of the Institute closer to the west side of the country so we can serve this population. That's why we select Las Vegas. Plus, it's a great place to come.
Yeah, well, we've got, I don't know how many thousands and thousands of flights that come in here every day. Last week, they just announced our numbers, our tourism numbers for 2016, and I believe it was 42.9 million visitors.
Oh my God.
Came to Las Vegas. Almost, yeah. 43 million people came here last year, which is unheard of. And they fly from every country in the world and every state in the union right here. So you're going to have access to that pipeline, which I think is huge.
Yeah, when I was talking to you yesterday, you said something that never crossed my mind. You said that we practically create or develop the initial stage of touristic medicine.
Medical tourism. I think, yeah, you're the godfather of it. I look and I go, back then it wasn't called medical tourism. People were just traveling for the best care that they could find, and that was you.
Yeah. We serve in that way, but I never put my mind in that type of a concept till you talked to me yesterday. So the concept that you are saying that you have 40 million people coming here, if we have a good service, we will also capture some of that population because they will be curious to see in Las Vegas, not only to come over to have an entertainment that they're looking for, but at the same time to seek healthcare.
So, for those folks that are new to joining the show, about 3 years ago, we started on the journey about 5 years ago. And then about 3 years ago, we wrote a regional strategic plan for medical tourism. Scott, if you could throw up just a thumbnail of that plan. We just published the two-year study or the two-year accomplishment report. And a lot of that is how do we position Las Vegas to become the world's most globally recognized destination for health and wellness travel? And I think attracting the Bonati Spine Institute here is a huge feather in our cap for the state of Nevada. And if you look at the plan, this was co-authored by a lot of folks. We had the Las Vegas Convention and Visitors Authority, who is ultimately responsible for 42.9 million people coming here last year. The UNLV School of Hotel Administration, who they are developing curriculum and research around the area of medical travel. Then we also had the Las Vegas Global Economic Alliance, which is looking at this as an economic development initiative. It's every time one of those patients flies out here, they're on a flight, they're staying in our hotels, they're creating jobs in the area. And then the Governor's Office of Economic Development. We know Governor Sandoval is very supportive of all of our medical tourism efforts. He's very proud, I'm sure, to have you in the state of Nevada and attracting these people out here. So, but I looked and I said, gosh, here's a guy that's been doing medical tourism since the 1980s. It wasn't even called medical tourism back then. Tell us a little bit about the population base that comes to the Florida Institute. I know they come from all the states and a lot of different countries, but touch on that a little bit if you could.
Well, medicine started to change in the 1980s. A great amount of corporations that acquire hospitals and clinics, and then they shelter their doctors on those type of conglomerates. So doctors in the past, they were able to relate to physicians for a referral system all over all over the state or all over the city. And then friendship and interaction between the physicians create a confidence. So the physician was good. The results of that physician was good. So then the doctors refer the patients one to the other one in a symbiotic mechanism. But when they start to create this amount of shelter institutions, like, for example, hospitals that they just acquire doctors, then the referral system change. And when the referral system change, I thought and I said, I have the whole country. Mm-hmm. I don't need to serve Florida. I need to serve whatever can come to me. And because the product that we had at that time was initially the first birth of minimally invasive surgery. Now, that birth was very attractive to the people because they thought, I don't want to have an incision of 6 inches on my back. I really am interested to see if they can solve my problem with an incision of half an inch.
Mm-hmm.
So that was enough to attract people. And then we start to open the markets by communication, by information. And then the next thing that happens is we start to receive people from all over the country and all over the world.
That's amazing. Somebody once told me about 80% of your patients come from outside of the Florida marketplace.
That's correct.
And that's exactly what we're trying to do here in Las Vegas. We've got 45,000 hotel rooms up and down Las Vegas Boulevard. We've got flights coming in from every country, and it's going to be a matter of attracting great doctors such as yourself to Las Vegas to start building all those pipelines. And we've seen a reasonable amount of success in the area of plastic surgery. Obviously, we've got some of the best plastic surgeons in the country that practice right here in Las Vegas, keeping our workforce looking good in areas of fertility, areas of cancer treatment, brain health with the Cleveland Clinic, and now we've got spine that we're attracting a lot of folks out here, and we're proud of that. We're going to get back to the why. I want to find out why your procedure is so unique compared to others, but we're going to come back to that later on in the show. I want to spend a little bit of time taking a look at last night and an event, and we had our photographer send over a bunch of photos. Here we've got the ribbon cutting, and we've got some great folks in there. It looks like you brought a lot of your team out from the Florida marketplace. And again, gosh, last night I think there was a little over 200 people there, and we heard nothing but amazing things. We had one of the folks that was there, we had Dr. Suzanne L. Ied, who is the current president of the Clark County Medical Society. So, Scott, if you could throw up a photo there, that would be wonderful. It's great that our local medical society came out to welcome you into the marketplace and sent out their leadership to make sure that know that you're welcome here. We're proud to have you here, and looking forward to seeing your institute bloom and blossom. So next time I turned my head, I saw you talking to the dean of the UNLV School of Medicine, which was good. So if you don't mind sharing, tell us what was going on in that conversation.
Well, I think this idea of a new university, new medical school here is brilliant. It's absolutely necessary. And if we're going to create doctors that they are loyal to the community and loyal to the state, needs to start in the medical school. At the same time, we need to be very sure that when we create those doctors, that they are sheltered to serve in the state. And to do that, we need to have opportunities. We need to have corporations, or we need to have institutions that they are going to offer good jobs to these doctors. Otherwise, they are going to migrate. And once the physician migrate from the state, they don't come back.
Sure.
So once you establish a practice, very difficult to move. So I do believe that the ideas that the dean of the medical school has is not only create students that they are going to become doctors, but at the same time create a type of training programs that they are going to train already physicians that they are trained in different specialties. So Las Vegas started to have the first quality of healthcare that deserve. One of the things that I am very enthusiastic and I discussed with her a little bit, very short, but enough to be able to see which direction she is thinking, is to create a fellowship for the spine. Creating a fellowship for the spine is very important because it's going to get doctors trained in the techniques that I have to that level that they are going to deliver then a tremendous amount of good results in patients that they are going to work in this area.
That's awesome. And it's you're always training doctors. You've got surgeons down there. You're teaching them the Bonati technique because it's different than every other technique. And it's great to watch you co-mingle with our dean, and hopefully we could put together a good relationship there. I think it'd be very, very instrumental for Las Vegas.
I think it would be a good idea for us and for them.
And you had a lot of folks up from your Florida office. You even relocated a couple of your top people, right? So I know Dr. John Grossmith, he's your medical director of Las Vegas. Tell us a little bit about Dr. Grossmith and how long he's been with you, some of the credentials that he has.
Dr. Grossmith is working with us for around 9 years. He's an incredible, incredible surgeon. He's probably the top surgeon on the institute, and that's what I trust on him to give him the responsibility to head this institution here. At the same time, we're training other doctors right now to work with him and continue the tradition of the surgeries from Florida here. So we will bring around four neurosurgeons to the institute here. And we will bring also anesthesiologists and general practitioners so we can serve the patients completely. We're looking to also open a radiological department so we can have a three-dimensional CAT scanner and also an MRI that can coordinate with the three-dimensional CAT scanner to have three-dimensional MRI vision. The communication between the facilities will be done through the internet and through the satellite. So any type of a situation that there is a conflict or a situation that needs consultation in the middle of the surgery, I will be able to see it from Florida. And the instrumentation will have some type of a bird view that will allow us through the scope to look exactly the area that's being operated in vivo right there.
That's cutting edge.
So with that, in case that they feel, for example, imagine that we have a patient. Remember that our procedure is with a patient practically with conscious sedation. Mm-hmm. So the patient communicates with you, understands what's happening. He's not, doesn't have pain, but is awake. So if you touch a nerve, the patient will feel. And if you touch the nerve and you run slowly on that nerve, you can localize exactly where the pain that the patient is suffering will be present. So when you do that and you touch that area, patient will say, that's exactly my pain. So then you can lift the nerve a little bit and look around to see why that area is being injured or is being affected. And if that happens, then sometimes it runs very easy and very, very fast. Some other times you just kind of find the area. So in those circumstances, they are going to communicate with me, and I will guide them to see, look here, or look at the other one, do this or do that, so we can pinpoint exactly and solve the problems for the patients.
Yeah, so you jumped a little bit ahead, and I like that. So I wanted to, we're now into the why of the procedure, and the conscious IV sedation is something that's unique. The patient's there, they're awake, they're collaborating with you, telling you where it hurts, how it hurts, and tell us a little bit about that.
Well, let me tell you, this was a real fight. when you develop something, when you are a pioneer on anything in the world, you always have two forces. You have the you trying to impose your opinion and your techniques, and you have the opposition, that is the force that is working with a different procedure for years. Mm-hmm. They are being trained at the universities. They live with that procedure. They create their constituency with and educate their surgeons with that procedure. So it's a big fight. The move that wall farther is a tremendous fight. So usually what happens is takes around 20 years to move that wall. And why you move the wall is not because you do something different. It's because the individuals that they are supporting the other wall, they start to disappear. They start to die, or they start to change concepts, or they become more accepted the idea of the change, and that moves the wall. At the same time, what really moved the wall is the patient. When the patient said, "You're not going to cut me 6 inches, I want 1 inch incision," then this other group start to lose patients. When they start to lose patients, they reorganize. They reorganize, they start to look at the techniques, and then they start to accept the techniques. But take 20 years to do that. So I have 20 years of horrendous fights to move this technique to the situation that is today. If you look at the internet 10 years ago, you would not see arthroscopic spine or minimally invasive spine surgeons on the internet. But if you look today, you have hundreds and hundreds of surgeons that they are talking about minimally invasive surgery. That's when the technique is moved. Now, when you look at this technique, you also need to distinguish the technique, because you have open surgery that requires instrumentation, that requires screws and plates and devices, that they do fusions and things like that. We don't believe on that. That to us is tools that they should be on the box of tools.
In the toolbox rather than in the body?
Exactly. So we believe that we need to, the concept that we have is a decompression of the nerve. If you free the nerve is going to perform normal. So the idea is to free the nerve and remove any type of an insult that can affect that nerve to give you the symptomatology that you're suffering with. So that is the whole concept. But the results with that concept are fantastic. But recently, because of the training, this technique is not really at the level of exposure in the country yet. We are still far, far away from the knowledge of this technique available to the surgeons. So they are another type of an idea. This other idea was to do the same open procedure with a small incision, and they call minimally invasive. This is not what we do. Mm-hmm. When you talk about minimally invasive and they talk about fusions and put devices in you and put the screws in you and the whole thing, that's not our procedure. Our procedure is a patent procedure. It's a procedure that we developed. And at that time, on the 1990s, physicians were able to patent the knowledge of a new procedure or a new tool. And when you patent the procedure, then you own that procedure. But when you patent the tool, you own that tool. But with the new law, you cannot patent a procedure. So the mental component of a new advance in medicine legally was removed by the legislators, and they said doctors cannot patent procedures. So there are no more patent procedures in the country, but they are patent tools. So the industry move with lobbying, remove the doctors from patent procedures and tools to be able to get themselves the tools and produce the tools and patent the tools for themselves, and they left the doctors out. So the doctors participate today with the industry, given the idea, but they don't really own the product.
Sure.
Well, before we were able to own the product, and that is the blessing that we have. We own the product. So nobody can imitate or nobody can touch what we do unless are being trained by us or unless it's part of a system where we educate them. And that's what we try to do here in Las Vegas, educate with our techniques exactly what we do. That is not what they call minimally invasive today, neither what they call open surgery today.
So I think you just touched on the why and why so many patients travel from all around the world to get the Bonati targeted procedure. So I want to come back to the event because we had a couple other things that we wanted to talk about the event. 200 people, we had nothing but compliments about the great food that was provided at the event from the good folks over at the Americana restaurant. We've got Chef Steve in there. Steven came over from Charlie Palmer, and this is a brand new restaurant up at Desert Shores, and they did an utterly amazing job. These folks, God, the food that they put out, I heard nothing but great compliments. And then we had another, we had an entertainer there last night by the name of Dirk. And Dirk is a German-born guitarist and trained in L.A., came up here to Las Vegas, and everybody seemed to enjoy the music that he played, especially my wife, who is German-born as well. And she enjoyed the conversation that she's able to have with Dirk. They grew up a couple hours from each other over in Germany outside of Cologne. But it was a great event last night, and I think we should probably close it up here because we're coming to the top of the hour. And Scott, if you could throw up the last shot of the ribbon cutting one last time. And Dr. Bonati, I want to thank you for being on the show. I want to welcome you to Las Vegas, and we wish you the highest level of success, and we thank you for coming out here, and thank you again for being on the show.
Thank you again for bringing me over.
Yes.